So what's your plan?
Okay, Mary, go ahead.
So what's your plan to operate this building? Because buildings of this size, and this size, are about $1,000 a month for heat, more for air conditioning. That doesn't even factor in any of the energy, any of the electricity, any of the lights, any of the equipment. We would all love to just do whatever we can. Just throw money at these kids, just build more buildings, do whatever we want. Hey, I'd love to buy your house. You can triple the size of my house, and that's wonderful. And I can afford to triple the size of my house. But to triple the size of my house also triples the size of the cost of the upkeep. And right now, we can't balance our budget. We are asking staff for concessions. We are taking away from teachers continually, taking away from staff members continually, every single year. We're hitting them up for money. And we're talking about no less than $60,000 a year in utilities. And also that 50 kids can have their dream classroom, or you can have your dream classroom, because like you said, it's kind of been your thing. That's over $13,000 per student. You told me that already that it's grant funded. And then we get all the propaganda here about Habitat for Humanity and extra students. Dakota has the same program. I promise you, they're taking as many students as anybody. Right now they're growing and we're not. So we're not doing anything to attract students, and $750,000 for building to attract students is just not fiscally responsible for us. But how can you say that Habitat for Humanity might be an option when you haven't even spoken with them? You just say that's a possibility. Or how can you say that Ferris State University is a possibility? That's 5 years ago. What consideration have you given to operating this? Because right now, everything that comes to us for this program right now, the grant funds, you're saying, benefits all of Hancock, but now we're going to go ahead and take that away and put it into a building.
Okay, I have an order here, Jackie, and then Amy, then Sharon, then Don.
Right, I just wanted to respond so that he doesn't need to. Back in 2005, when this bond issue was put together, and actually obviously much before that, with a lot of committee work, there was a vision for this district. And the vision included rigorous classes in our traditional high schools, middle schools, elementary schools, your standard core areas. Arts, athletics were all built. I remember building, enhancing our fields. I remember adding storage to our band rooms. I remember adding classrooms throughout this process. This was a part of the vision from this board and from the community. What I think is really amazing about this vision is that there is a place for every student. So whether it's a kid who loves AP courses and loads their schedules with it, whether it's an art kid, whether it's a kid who really just comes for football and goes to class because they have to, or whether it's a kid who takes advantage of one of our CTE programs, there's a place for everyone. And that's what this is doing. This is adding a place. Now, you are absolutely correct that through this bond program, the changes that we have made have been honored what we promised to the community, what they voted for, have sometimes added to our utility costs and sometimes saved on our utility costs, depending on the kind of project we had. If we build additional facilities, there will be additional utility costs. There's no doubt about that related to this. However, we also have the energy management contract and we are continuing to break costs out. So our hope would be that we will be saving more costs in the future. This is a part of a vision that came forward that our community voted for.
Okay, I have Amy.
Okay, I have several questions. Number one, the vision of 2005 was kind of like, has to be looked at again because in 2008, and other students. So how many districts do we have students coming in that goes into this program?
The greatest amount of students come in from Richmond. We've had some from Mount Clemens. We've had the second greatest number come from Lutheran North. So the greatest number come from Richmond, second come from Lutheran North, and actually Mount Clemens in the last, we don't have any students in this program from Mount Clemens in the last 6 years. However, we've had an increase in enrollment from Mount Clemens in all of our CTE programs because Mount Clemens School is looking to farm their kids out. We've been absorbing them as Hanko. And so we've seen an increase in enrollment from Mount Clemens overall, and I can make an assumption, I think, that we're going to see some of those numbers coming to construction. But as far as all the other sending schools, Lakeshore has a program. New Haven has something similar that seems to attract their kids. We've got a couple kids from Merritt Academy. And, actually this year, Lakeview Schools have approached us. I forgot about that. They approached us because Lakeshore is full of their construction program. They want to send their kids to us. So there's 5 kids that are coming from Lakeview this year. We can't guarantee them all the seats, but we've been approached by Lakeview.
So they bring dollars with them?
Yes. They bring the FTE and the added cost.
You make contact with Habitat for Humanity, you were talking to them, but there's no contact. And you talked to her, someone said something about mobile homes?
A Habitat house, there's 2 ways in which they're built. There's the site builds where people volunteer, and there's a couple, you know, construction managers and some carpenters that help people like you and I help everybody else to build a house. Then there's modular builds that are built in two halves with a marriage wall in between, and so that is what Dakota does. That's what the other 6 programs around the state do. They have Habitat.
But you don't have contact with them, so you have no guarantee that you will get some of Dakota's business.
Absolutely not. No guarantee.
So we're going to build a building that's about $130 a square foot, is it? And it looked like a pole barn to me. It's insulated, obviously. And when we had a private conversation when we were talking, you said it'd be brick wall partway up and then?
We've had to make several adjustments, yeah. The original size, by the way, the original size, we were talking 10,000 square feet of space. We're down to less than that. Mm-hmm.
So currently it's 60 by 80.
Yeah.
With the bathrooms. Yeah. It's open area. Are we going to have to buy more equipment to go in there?
Yes.
That's an additional cost that we haven't even talked about yet.
It'll cost the district nothing. It's all 61A cost funds. All, just let me give you sort of an example. Last year when I came on board, the budget, CPE budget for Panko from the state was $276,000. 100% of that has to be spent on materials, equipment repair, upgrades, things like that. It cannot be on salaries and whatever else. When the state increased the budget last year, I went from $276,000 to $458,000. So there's a big interest in CTE. All of that money, and we're not going to see that next year, and there's reasons why. We're going to start getting close. Basically, this year's money is based on last year's numbers, and we were running 2-year programs, and we couldn't switch it back to 1-year programs because there wasn't enough time to get all the segments done. That's the short story. But all of that equipment will be paid for with state dollars, nothing from us.
If Habitat for Humanity does not do a contract with us, what will you do?
Smaller projects.
Building projects and sheds?
Yeah, that's kind of what we've been doing the last year. And what's interesting about that is, so that's one way in which to build things and get the kids building things, and we sort of auction them or sell them off. A lot of other programs around the state have, for example, a model program that I haven't visited yet, but John visited just last year, is out in Oakland County. And they have modular setup. So, for 1 week, the kids are going to do floor framing. And after they get done with that, they're going to do wall framing, and they're going to do roof framing. And then, and they start, and they're working in these little pods, groups of, you know, five or six kids, sometimes two or three kids. And they're working on maybe electrical circuits for a week or two. And then they move on to plumbing, and they move, and they get all the segments, but they're not constructing an entire house. And what's interesting is that that model is actually what happens at the Plum Community College, it's what happens at Ferris State, it's what happens at Norman. So what we've been doing by building houses, we were doing basically because it was a cheap way to go in the past. When you know, Armstrong could buy lots for $3,000 or $4,000, and then you know, we construct a house for $50,000 and sell it for $100,000. It was a boom for the district. That's not the case anymore. We can't buy a lot for less than $40,000 or $50,000, and the house costs us $100,000 or $100,000 or $125,000 to build. So being in the housing business isn't necessarily the way to go. It's just the way we've gone, and it's a way in which we can go with Habitat if we want to do that. If this group says that's the direction I want you to take this, believe me, that's the direction I will go. I've been so involved with this since 2000, before I even came to Pinto, that you know, at some point I stopped making phone calls and making things happen until this vote happens. Okay, because I've been spinning my wheels for a long time. And so if this happens, you'll start to see some things move forward. If that's the direction that this group wants me to go, I will pursue that relationship further with that. I've got the CODIS contract, I've got copies of what they, you know, their agreement with Habitat. Habitat is placing, you know, they're placing houses right off of Joy Boulevard, like right down the street, a perfect location for us.
So,
hold on. I have Sharon, then Don, and then Mary. Mm-hmm. Oh, Sharon? All right.
I appreciate that when the vision was discussed in 2005. A lot of things are different. The team has to go out short-term and long-term vision. And we have to make adjustments according to what's going on in your county. So yes, things in 2008 went really south. But I think this has been talked about for quite some time. You have made some significant changes to bring it to a smaller size, smaller cost, for what we need this board had approved 1 year ago. We had parents and students and some of us on the board saying for a long time that CTE is something that this district really needs to start waking up on, and these experts are coming and our local businesses are having asked them for. It's what local businesses are going to our community colleges and asking for, and so it's incumbent upon us, I believe, as a district to follow in those same plans and footsteps. We need to start preparing our students for what's out there in the current academy. I appreciate that we've had a lot of financial things that we need to adjust and change and dial back on, but I even at this point think that dialing back on this program has been in the works for a long time, and something that's been approved 1 year ago is something we should be doing right now. I think when we keep moving forward, we've got some efficiencies of cost going on in a number of different ways. So yes, there will be costs for heating and lighting and all that sort of thing. But I think that in the end, when we throw all this stuff together, we're going to find it's going to be one of the best decisions that we have carried forward and added positively.
Okay, thank you. Don?
When I started, one of the first things I did, I was involved with the bond committee first, planning committee. And part of the expression from the community was to provide equal facilities to all of our students, from band, choir, math, science, career tech ed, etc. No student was to be left out. That was the vision that came from the community, and the board approved that. That's what our community voted on. That was the promise that we made, that all students would be provided with the facility and to create the opportunity. We do go through an economic downturn. I mean, it's had significant impact, but we've also seen significant growth in demand in trades. In Michigan, as I said, we've seen a significant amount of investment interest from from 51A, from the state in investment in career tech planning, to the reauthorization of the Perkins Act federally, which is getting a lot of discussion recently on the type of growth. We've got a couple districts in Macomb County, Romeo being one, that's providing a new program to employability, that they're going to focus on job skills training next year, and there's another district that's another year after degrees, recognizing that much of what's happened in our economy has put a demand on the workforce and the opportunity to provide our students with job skills training is definitely being recognized both locally in Macomb County, in the state, and nationally. We made this promise to the district and to the community. This is what they voted on. This type of commitment, although scaled back to represent the economic times that we had, is part of the original plan that we followed through with what Jackie had said, whether it was band programs or choir or math or the science test. We've done it all. And this is one of the last things that we promised that we were going to do. And I wish it was more, but I'm optimistic that they'll provide opportunities for our students, and again, all of our students deserve equal opportunity.
Okay, Mary?
So, 18 students per class. We have cut how many electives at our regular high schools, and 18 students per class. That class is taught every single time. First of all, 18 students per class is horrible, and it is not fair to every other kid who wants to take an elective but can't take it now because we have 18 students per class in this building. I think that's a poor decision to start with. I guess I'm completely floored that you need $750,000, $750,000, before you can talk to Habitat for Humanity and put things in place, before you can actually come to us with an actual plan and say, I've talked with these people, this is the plan, this is how we go about it, this is what we do, and yes, they're interested in this. Okay? Then you come to us and ask for $750,000, $75,000 of it is going to go just to the architect. Okay? You're not asking to have our kids build this building. If it's a construction trades program, then these kids should be building it, right?
We haven't pursued that, and it's not an option.
How would you know if it's an option? You haven't even talked to Habitat. How would you know?
First of all, I have talked to Habitat. I wasn't going to pursue a contract until we have it, so.
Pursuing a contract is different than putting a plan in place.
If that is the plan that we want to be building houses. That is not the only way to teach Plum Level. Square is a way. It's a way of doing it that other districts have done. I have thought it as a possible option. I presented it to the board as an option. It's something that's entirely doable, especially with a neighboring district who's doing it, who would, you know, like I said, hold our hand through the process for the first year or two. But, you know, if I were back in the classroom doing it again, that would not be my first choice of the way to do it. Just to be honest with everybody here, that would be not the way that I would want to teach the class. I would want to teach it more in a modular approach like they do at the university level. Building a house that has to go out and now, you know, every single house that I built as a district that I had my builder's license on, still to this day, my name is on the license. That house had to be better than the ones next door, and it had to be perfect when it was done. That's a high demand to put on 15, 16, 17-year-old kids. That demand was entirely on me. And I don't necessarily know if that's what we'd want to be doing to a teacher. I did it knowing it because I was young, and I was a lot stronger, and a lot more agile. You know, didn't weigh quite as much. But I was anxious about the program, the direction things were going, and the opportunity that it afforded. But through the years, I learned it was not the best way to do it. So it is a way to do it, and it's a way that I presented to this group as a possibility. If that's the direction we want to go, I will pursue it.
$750,000 for 15 students.
stop. Everybody's doing this. What is it that you think that this is going to change from everybody else?
I'm not so sure.
Go ahead, please. What is different between this and Dakota and Richmond and Anchor Bay and all these other programs? What's better? What's different? What makes this so fabulous? What makes it worth $750,000 of our taxpayers' money? Now, we've already built several houses. And the last house, if I recall correctly, we took quite a little spanking on. I think we lost like $50,000 or $60,000. We've already been told that all of the materials are grant funded. How do you lose $50,000 or $60,000
in materials? So we discussed how we lost the money, and it was because of the time of the lots we purchased, the price of the property that we were buying was so expensive.
And when the
houses were finally done one at a time, which takes a couple years of thinking, that the cost of houses was actually lower, and that's why there was a loss on those buildings.
And at the time, we also were not told that that all the materials are grant funded. If all the materials are grant funded, how do you lose money? Even with the change of the cost of the lots. How do you just
not break even? I just ask, please, that I understand, Mary, that you have the questions that you do, and I'm saying that, of course, ask questions. If we're on the motion to approve this, and should we just try to stay on the motion?
I make a motion to call the question.
Okay, I got a motion from Trustee Blatcher, seconded by Treasurer Hornberger, to call for the question. This is just on the call for the question. All those in favor calling for the question say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, carried unanimously. We're on the motion. I'll take roll call vote on the motion.
Mr. Hubel?
Yes.
Mrs. Ross, yes. Mrs. Servio?
No.
Mrs. McClatchy?
Yes.
Mrs. Hornberger?
Yes.
Mrs. Hilton?
No.
Mr. Perry?
Yes.
5-2.
Motion carries.
Let's see.
Okay. We're going to go next on our agenda, which I believe we are at Human Resources Office, correct? Human Resources Update, is that?
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
Mr. Peck, I was hoping to have the negotiations update at the end of the meeting to take the place for the HR update at this time.
Okay, great. Good report. Okay, we're going to go on to School Community Relations Office, guidelines for public notice.
Publish legal notices and newspapers in general circulation within the area of the school district. Historically, the school district has published legal notices in the Macomb Daily. Trent Law Firm has advised the school district to formally select a specific newspaper within the district to publish legal notices on an annual basis. Many of such notices have been reviewed by the business office in conjunction with the Office of Public and Community Relations, and it is recommended that the Board of Education authorize the guidepost for publishing legal notices and the Macomb Daily for the 2016-17 fiscal year.
So moved.
No second.
Motion by Trustee Blatcher, seconded by Vice President Servio. Any questions? All right, seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Carried unanimously. We're going to go to unfinished business. I have nothing under unfinished business. I'll go to new business. And is there anything under new business? I don't have anything.
Okay.
Oh, go ahead.
As we talked last meeting about a paying lawyer on retainer, I'd like that added to the agenda. write, do you do an RFP or?
But didn't we approve the lawyer's list for this coming school year? And so we're looking at an RFP not until the school year of 17, 18.
That's the question that at the time, when we were just in it, it wasn't a contract, that if we were agreeing over.
We selected those firms. We selected those firms.
I was too then, because I was understanding that we were going to be using those attorneys and put them on the RFP for a, and I guess I can review the minutes to see what it says exactly. I don't know if it has years in place, but I was on the impression that we would use those attorneys and put on an RFP.
No, not at all.
Okay. Jackie, do you have something?
Well, I was just going to say that I certainly can put together an RFP, and I heard that request. It will not be done for next year. So, okay. And if you want to put it on the agenda, we can talk about it, but it won't be available for the next month. That's just too soon.
Go ahead.
I have a question that we back early, I think it was the beginning of the end of June, we asked about the administration building, and Jackie very kindly sent us a detailed explanation of what's going on. But my question is, are we going to put that building, do we have that building in the hands of a real estate agent to sell it, or are you going to privately sell it? What's it doing?
Well, we are still working on the township. I'm on the discussion, so right now it's just a conversation between us and the township. We're thinking about it in December later, but we need to do it all.
Is this the part where we sell the building to the township and then demolish the other and sell the lots or sell the other buildings or? I guess clarification would be good. Because while I read the emails,
I guess so the board, my understanding, the board needs to make a decision. There's two options, and the board needs to make a decision. Maybe if we want to put this on the agenda for our next meeting for a discussion, maybe a direction.
I think that'd be very good.
Are you, is it right?
I'm
going
to talk about it, but it will not be that.
Okay, so it's not.
I would like some kind of an update, only because this has been going on for so long. The building has been sitting there for so long without any progress. So.
If you've been in discussions with the township.
My apologies, I thought we were talking about the.
No. So we could get some kind of clarification on. Again, because I know I've asked
for
that before, and we've gotten it, but that was months and months ago.
Okay, right. So, I'm sorry, I'm building. So, is it right for a decision, or at least a discussion next meeting? Right? Okay, for the building, the old administrative building. Right. Okay. Is there anything else under new business? No? Okay. Correspondence? Do you have any? None? Board members request RFP for superintendent search firm. I'd just like to give a quick background on this, please. We did have a workshop last week. We came up with an RFP for a superintendent. There were questions that the trustees and board had in regards to certain points that I was requested to reach out to the superintendent for answers. I believe she provided those answers. And in providing those answers, and she had pointed out to me the fact that there are different points of pride that I believe would be more current and accurate. So I had asked that we have two documents in our packet. One's the superintendent search RFP that was discussed and discussed and approved, so to speak, at the workshop. And then the second is the superintendent RFP search with the updated points of pride. I looked through the points of pride. I sent the new points of pride out to the board over the weekend to take a peek at. I think that they are very reflective of what the district represents. So at this time, if we can have hopefully a brief discussion on the RFP, or if there's a direction that the board, or one other point was, there was something in the old RFP about a 90% approval rate from parents that when I also asked the superintendent about that, she said that that's probably old and we haven't done a survey like that in quite some time. We did a survey of the public, but we didn't do a survey of the parents. So I don't know if that is exactly accurate, so I said that maybe we should take that out. So other than that, you have the two documents in front of you, and if there's a direction you want to take, I would open the floor now for some discussion. Okay, Linda?
I think the points of pride are very good, and I think it just gives a little better picture of what our district is all about. Is it something that's absolutely necessary to be in this RFP? I don't know, but I don't think it can hurt. I think it's a good starting point for when we start getting down into the profile of the district to start using these points of pride to show the individuals that are, what our district is more about. So I think we should just go with that, go with the final RFP that has the additional points of pride. It's not going to hurt. I don't think it's something that's absolutely necessary to be in this RFP because these are things that if a search firm is interested in, they should probably can get it off of our website or by doing a little bit of research, but it's not going to hurt. So I would make a recommendation that we go with the additional points of pride as submitted and get this RFP out for pursuant to our diagram.
Okay, so there's a motion from...
Make a motion that we submit, that we send out the request for proposal for superintendent search firm. Be the last document that has the additional points of pride added to it.
Okay, seconded by Treasurer Servio. Are there any questions?
Yes. I do have one.
Linda?
Sorry about
that. Okay.
On page 207, where we list the district facilities included, we list the administration building. I think we need to change that to the actual name of this building, right? The Harry L. Weaver Community Center and Administrative Offices. We did, well, I don't know. But and also, we need to change the color. This is not a superintendent search. This is a superintendent's, or a first search for superintendent. So the color sheet needs to be changed.
Okay.
Name of the administration building.
Okay, we have those two changes. Okay, how they were close from minor. Okay, Mary, and then Don? I'm sorry, Sharon was first, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
It's to get 90%, I think a little conversation about that, and I remember we did do a community survey, but something was said in my head that we had done something like last year, the year, maybe a year before the parents, and I don't, maybe after you have the community survey, to start in front of everybody.
I did put together a survey just a few years ago, but that was asking parents in regards to marketing questions.
No,
we didn't get the specifications of satisfaction with the district.
Yeah, that's why I kept sticking in my head, like we've gotten this number from somewhere. So, okay, thanks for the clarification.
Okay, Mary?
So, while I'm not posting points of credit, in all honesty, I don't think it makes a huge difference one way or the other when you're looking for a search firm. I think that we should be very careful as a board inserting or allowing the superintendent to insert her positions into our search. This is our responsibility, and once we allow input from our superintendent, our current superintendent, that no longer makes it our process, it does make it hers. And I don't think we can be effective looking for a superintendent if she's continually inserting herself in this process.
Okay, well, this is a point of information on that. I did when I had to go over the facts for her on what information we were lacking, she had mentioned these things to me, so I thought they were important. So I actually told her first off, no, I don't think we should, but then the more I thought about it, it's not my decision to make, it's the board's decision to make. So that's right, that's why we're here, we're a collective body, and but I understand what you're saying. I hear you. I just wanted to point out for the public that are just an important timeline is that if you haven't had a chance, if the public hasn't had a chance to read the RFP yet, is that you know, proposals will be coming back after it's approved today by August 19th, and then we'll open them publicly, open in the red at the administration building here, and so then it'll be by 4 p.m. And then after that, yes. Okay, August 31st, we start the interviews, and then after that, they're going to help us after we pick the firm to develop a timeline for hiring an interim superintendent and a permanent superintendent. So. Okay. Yes.
It was just brought to my attention in regards to all the buildings that were listed. Right now it says Riverside Academy, and we would want to change that to the Diane and Palm Summit.
Okay. Okay. That's another change. And then.
Are you writing this down or do you need to?
Yes. I wrote it down.
Okay. Yeah. Right now during your workshop.
Yes, I was thinking I was doing present. Yes, thank you. Okay. Are there any other questions or comments on the RFP? All right. Seeing none. Yes. Don, sorry.
I brought this up at the workshop, and I'll bring up again the idea under four acceptance of proposal. Currently, it states the Board of Education is actually to accept that the proposal will not bind the district in more than 50% of selected firms' price or fee unless the Board of Education takes action to hire a candidate, propose the selected firm in the time limit specified in this RFP. We've identified two separate steps. We said we're going to do an interim superintendent, and we've also suggested the general discussion, although not in action to the board, is that further approval would take place after the new board is elected. In November, that much of the work to be done is going to be done by a potentially different group than here. I reiterate my concern to obligate this new board or the district to a full 50% payment if they choose to take whatever action they choose to. So we are obligating no matter what, even if we stick with that interim. Let's say we find an interim and we say we want to keep it. That legally you could argue that the board would have to pay the search firm the full 50% of the fee. I